Добрий день, шановні глядачі! Вітаємо вас на телепрограмі «Ліберто Контакт». Я Василь Яворський. Союз Українського студентства Канади був створений в 1953 році. Українські студентські організації існують в багатьох університетах Канади, аж понад 25. СУСК об'єднує всі ці організації в одну всеканадську спілку. А щороку члени СУСКу з місцевих організацій збираються на конгрес, де вони беруть участь в зборах і розвагах. Цьогорічний конгрес Союзу Українського студентства Канади, або СУСК, відбувся в містечку Бенф серед скелястих гір Альберти. Цей з'їзд, або конгрес, був проведений в Бенф Center for Arts and Creativity. Члени складових організацій СУСКу, які діють в університетах по цілій Канаді, провели 4 дні на цій конференції. Вони приїхали з цілої Канади, щоб брати участь в конгресі. Крім обміну досвіду про працю своїх організацій, студенти і гості мали нагоду дізнатись багато про інтернування українців в Канаді під час Першої світової війни. Вони почули на цю тему цікаві промови дослідників, художників і провідників української громади в Канаді. Перші два промовці розповіли присутнім про те, як наша громада досліджувала інтернування в Канаді і доказала урядовцям, щоб вони визнали, що це відбулося, і почали виправляти цей злочин проти людства. Перший промовець – це доктор Любомир Люцюк, який є професором політичних наук в Royal Military College of Canada. А другий – це був Андрій Гладашевський, голова Канадської фундації імені Тараса Шевченка.
I want to share with you a clarion call, if you like, an evocation, a recollection about a man who I think was one of the great heroes of our community from the Second World War, a man by the name of Gordon Richard Baldon Panchuk from Saskatchewan, a teacher, a member of the Orthodox Church, a man who during the Second World War volunteered to serve overseas with the Royal Canadian Air Force, and who, as a result of his activities overseas during the war and after the war, helped save literally thousands of Ukrainian political refugees and displaced persons, slave laborers and the like. Some of them your parents or grandparents and certainly people you knew. Panchuk was one day asked why he had done what he did. Why did he spend years overseas when he could have come home with the other veterans in 1945 and gotten on with his life? Instead, he remained overseas for several more years to save DPs. He said, well, I have a very simple gospel. And it's what you see here above you. My gospel, do something. Robishosh. And I remember when I was working with Baldon Panchuk and studying his papers and writing about them, that struck me as probably one of the best kind of statements about who we are and what we should be doing. We need to do something.
This is where internment starts with me. It then starts in law school. I did a paper called The Tyranny of British Parliamentary Supremacy, The Case of the Japanese Canadians. My civil liberties prof was a guy named Jerry Gall, nice Jewish guy. Assigned me this, and then he said, you know, Andrew, I would have assigned you something on the Ukrainians. There's nothing out there. Like, there's nothing for you to research. There's nothing out there. This would have been in the late 70s, early 80s. There's no material. There's a ton of material on the Japanese Canadians and the academics studying it, and it's all recent stuff because the records were still around. And the premise is the British parliamentary supremacy, which Canada has, the supremacy of parliament and of the legislatures, is that within their constitutional authority, they can do anything to people, which is why the War Measures Act was valid law. The regulations promulgated by the War Measures Act was valid Canadian law. Ukrainian who were interned went after it. They had no recourse.
Андрея Малиш походить з роду одного з тисячів інтернованих людей в Канаді під час Першої світової війни. Тепер вона є голова Canadian First World War Internment Recognition Fund.
Good morning. I bring greetings from our chair, Mr. Emil Durenduk, on behalf of the Endowment Council of the CFWWIRF for a very successful conference. We know that there were 24 internment camps across Canada, and with research being done, we're now aware that there were more than 24 internment camps and receiving stations, and I will be able to speak to you about the variety of projects that we are funding. Of course, we've mentioned that Bill C-331 by Mr. Inky Mark, former MP, Dauphin, Manitoba. Here is he unveiling a plaque, a stole plaque, the Interment of Persons Ukrainian Origin Act, received royal assent November 25th, 2005. He is the friend of our community, and we do give him thanks for this.
This weekend was a great opportunity to meet new people and learn more about the Ukrainian community.
Ряд дослідників про інтернування розповіли присутнім про свої особисті праці. Це були Касандра Люцюк, Михаїл Бьорж і Сера Бульєв, а модератором розмов була Ронда Гінтер.
Ukrainian-Canadian history is one of my interests, my areas of specialization. And in the past several years, I've developed a really keen interest in the history of internment in Canada that's grown out of my research on the Ukrainian left. So this includes an interest in not only World War I internment history, but also comparative approaches to other internment affected communities in Canada. So looking at World War II, looking at other situations in Canada that have been forms of internment by other means.
So as you know, we're all here to talk about new and upcoming research on Canada's first national internment operations. And I would argue that, albeit differently, what each of us are doing is contributing to a second wave of internment research. And so what I mean by this is that preceding us was a first generation of academics and activists, some of whom are in this room, who you've already heard from today, who were critical in establishing the fundamentals of this narrative. Right? So I like to say that this group determined the five W's of internment, right? So who, what, where, when, and perhaps most importantly, why. And they also were able to situate internment within its larger historical context. So they drew attention to state-sanctioned xenophobia. They also talked about the imposition of racial hierarchies in Canada.
My talk today stems from my background as an economic historian and my interest in pulling issues like internment out of a special box and into the history of both Canada and the world. I've done similar work before regarding Japanese internment in World War II, where I challenged the narrative that the interned Japanese were a placid minority, finding hundreds of examples of riots, strikes, and resistance in the camps. There are many ways to look at internment, to make it understandable, and to clarify the realities. The lens I've chosen to see internment through is as a part of the history of political policing, of xenophobia and racism, of the abrogation of rights, of wage and population control, and of course, of carceral excess. These are all topics that have extensive mirrors in Canadian history, and connecting them to wider contextual specifics, including transnational ones, will be the defining feature of this research moving forward.
When I first asked my mom where she was born, she replied, "I was born in a little village just outside of Montreal." So of course, being a nice guy of Kincaid, I could see this nice little village. There was snow on the roof, there were yellow windows, and smoke coming out of the chimney. And then I find out she was born in a concentration camp in a tar paper shack in the middle of nowhere. I first interviewed this gentleman for my master's work a number of years ago, and after speaking with him, I realized I was hooked. This was a story that needed to come out, and the field of archaeology could help. In that moment, I decided that this would become my life's work. The Morrissey World War I internment camp is a Canadian concentration camp, concealed on the landscape, long forgotten in collective memory, and almost completely and purposefully erased from history. Today, I will discuss how the discipline of archaeology can support social justice by contributing invaluable information when there is a dearth of documentary evidence.
Connor Moen, національний координатор СУСКу, і також Андрій Гладишевський розповіли студентам про те, як можуть українські студентські спілки отримати субсидії від уряду або різних організацій.
Grant writing, that's what made this project possible, that's what helps all of our organizations. It's one of the many ways that our clubs can bring revenue. And why do we need revenue? To actually give ourselves capacity and make these things happen. So there's sponsorships, I worked with a lot of you on that, there's memberships,
there's donations. Today we're just going to focus on grants. These are all different important ways of getting funds for your club. They all matter and they're all related to each other, and they all have different sort of practices. Grant writing, of course, is probably the most intimidating.
If you ever wanted to know what it was in a mouthful, here you go. It's a national chartered philanthropic institution dedicated to the preservation, promotion and development of the Ukrainian-Canadian cultural heritage, and to the advancement of a flourishing Ukrainian community for the enrichment of Canada. This is very important, right? This isn't an ethnic thing. This is a Canadian foundation for the enrichment of Canada by providing leadership in building and sustaining a permanent endowment fund.
Увечері студенти і гості подивилися документальний фільм про інтернування під назвою «That Never Happened». А після показу цього вражаючого фільму директор Райан Бойко виступив з промовою.
When that whole project was complete, we had done what we set out to do, but I found that there were two key elements that were missing. Number one, what happened to the women and children? And number two, why does it matter? And who cares? And so that's the two things that I've tried to answer with this documentary. So basically from the, October 2015 until June of 2017, in order to have this as well as the web series, we kind of worked them together. This morning during Dr. Cordon's presentation, I got an email that confirmed that I can make the announcement tonight. This film has been selected by the Mission of Canada to the United Nations to screen at the United Nations in Geneva this September for the 70th anniversary of the Declaration of Human Rights.
The movie was very moving because I wasn't aware of how widespread the internment operations were.
Наступного ранку студенти брали участь в екскурсії до пам'ятника та музею про інтернування українців під час Першої світової війни. Автор книги «No Free Man» доктор Богдан Кордан проводив цю екскурсію.
Welcome to all here at this particular site. The commemorative statue that honors the memory of 8,579 individuals who were interned in Canada during the course of the Great War, but also in particular the 660 men who labored at a site not far from here. This is not the original internment campsite. The original internment campsite is down the road, anywhere between 500 meters and a kilometer, and it's in a relatively open clearing near the river. And there you'll find the remnants of a camp, barbed wire, posts, various other kinds of certain remnants.
We originally went to Castle Mountain, and this is the Cave and Basin site. Cave and Basin site is essentially the winter quarters for the internment camp here in Banff. And it basically was established in November of 1915. And then they retreated back to the mountain in May of 1916, and this went on until the year 1917. This particular site is, I think, famous for a number of reasons. Really, this is really the birthplace of Canada National's park system. And it's really somewhat ironic that internment took place here, which did so much to develop the parks, and yet so little is known about it. This facility was created in 2012, I believe, through the efforts of the Ukrainian community and other communities against, frankly, great odds. You know, the idea that Canada has interned its peoples not once, not twice, but three times is a stain on sort of the historical honor and historical record of Canada and its commitment to freedoms, liberties, and rights, if you will. And this is, it's a record that in many ways is not to one that Canada was willing to acknowledge. And yet,
here we are.
Мене звати Стефанія Недошитко, я президентка Союзу українського студентства Канади, і через кілька днів ми тримали наш щорічний конгрес, який мав спеціальний фокус на інтернування українців. Через 4 дні студенти вчилися про інтернування українців, вони вчилися про студенти від інших культур, і вони також вчилися, як бути провідники в громаді.
Після їхнього відвідування музею відбулися вибори на різні позиції в управі Союзу українського студентства Канади. Кандидати мали виступити і всім розповісти, чому вони підходять на ці позиції. Цілий ряд місців та артистів розповів студентам про те, як їхня праця допомагає суспільству зрозуміти те, що пережили українці в Канаді стосовно з інтернуванням. Ці артисти були Райан Бойко, Кері Парнелл і також Джон Бокстел, який був присутнім через Skype. Модератором розмови був Ворен Войтек.
So again, I'd encourage you to think about this question. What is it that an arts-based approach can do to enhance how we conventionally learn about history? We don't have to look too far to see that the usual approach to history can be criticized because we have students who aren't remembering the facts that we think that they need to know. So how can an arts-based approach help with that?
I had the money to make the documentary, but I still wanted to make a film. I wanted to make it filmic, cinematic. I wanted to have impact, I wanted to tell a story. I didn't want it to preach, I wanted it to be something that people could converse about afterwards. And so I find a lot of documentaries are very preachy. They come with a very narrow lens, a very narrow angle, and they tell you what to believe. I didn't want to do that. I wanted to put out the facts in a way that makes sense and in a way that people can go, yeah, I'm for internment. Yeah, I'm totally against it. How can you be against it? You just saw this thing. Well, how, you know, creates a conversation.
So I am an artist. I've been interested in art my whole life. I'm from Winnipeg, and I've always loved the murals and the music, and I find that art paints the energy of a place. And as I grew up and I traveled, and on road trips, I would often, you know, see a cafe with a mural on the side and have to go in because it's got this energy about it. And so I've always been gravitated to it, so I guess it's a part of me.
To the making of the sculptures, the Ukrainians, by Lubomir Lushuk. He came to me in 1986 when I was working on a maquette for the 100th year anniversary of the Ukrainians in Canada. That project fell through, and he asked me if I was interested in making sculptures to replace plaques. And so I took it on because I remember my father being taken to concentration camp one time in 1942 in the middle of February, and we were all standing out on the sidewalk in the freezing rain.
Голова Національного конгресу українців Канади Павло Грод разом з Ігорем Михальчишином влаштували презентацію під назвою Advocacy 101.
The purpose of this session, it's called Advocacy 101, but really what we want to do, Ivan and myself, is to have a very practical walkthrough of some advocacy strategies and how to build an advocacy plan. No matter what you're interested in, if you're interested in politics, if you're interested in business, if you're interested in culture or anything else, advocacy is an extremely important skill set that you need to learn and hone in on. I use it, and thanks to my engagement and activities as a student leader in SUSK, and my activities as an activist in the UCC, I've been able to refine my advocacy skills and use it on all different fronts. whether you're seeking that first date, you need to have great advocacy skills. Whether you're trying to secure that first career opportunity, you need to have great advocacy skills. Whether you're in business, myself as CEO of Rodan Energy, I use advocacy skills all the time. Whether it's in sales, you're trying to sell a client on something, that's advocacy. You're trying to secure a change in government regulation as a business owner, that's advocacy. You're trying to attract investors into your business, that's advocacy. So these are skills that you're going to use throughout, whether it's, again, in business, government, social, cultural, or other issues or policies. And the whole purpose of it is you need to make a difference, whether it's for your own benefit or for the benefit of others.
So this is a little bit of sort of the inside of our, you'll see through the presentation, our sort of four-pronged strategy. So relationships, as Paul said, it's about not just showing up when you want something done, it's about knowing that politician or that government official has an ongoing dialogue with you, so they can call you if they have a question, you can call them, we stay in touch.
В останній вечір Конгресу відбувся святковий бенкет. Головний промовець цього вечора був Марк О'Ніл, голова Канадського музею історії.
Thank you very much for inviting me to this evening. It's a pleasure to be here with you today. When Lumiere Lichuk first told me about this, I immediately said yes. This is a very important community to me personally and to our museum, so I want you to know that. I'm delighted and honored to be here with you this evening. So my thanks to the Ukrainian Canadian Students Union and also to all of you involved in putting this together. All these things are very, very challenging and great deal of hard work. Your leader in those days was Christy Luchek, who I remember very well, and I mentioned a couple of you this evening. That's a long time ago, and SUSK was as active then as it's obvious to me as you are now, so congratulations on that. A few years later, as a young public servant, I was called into a meeting on a Friday afternoon. I remember it like it was yesterday afternoon, Friday afternoon, in 1993. With Honorable Sheila Feinstone, who was the Secretary of State for Multiculturalism and the Status of Women. And there's a fellow named George Ingram, a very, very nervous public servant from Park Stanley. And we were meeting with a fellow by the name of Lumiere Lichuk. And I remember that meeting very, very well. And it was a very, very tense meeting. I had never met Lumiere before. I knew very little about the sad and storied history of the internment operations of the First World War. And that, to me, was very much a developmental form of experience in my life.
Бувший президент СУСКу Касьян Салтикевич урочисто оголосив, що СУСК буде отримувати щорічні фонди від Шевченківської фундації.
This fund, managed by the Ukrainian-Canadian Foundation of Taras Shevchenko, will serve as a permanently endowed fund, and every year will provide funding to both СУСК and its member organizations. That means all of you. Tonight we are launching our fundraising campaign titled Finding Belonging, Creating Leaders, to build up the SUSK Endowment Fund with a principal goal of $600,000. Over the past few weeks and months, a committee of the SUSK executive, which I introduced at the beginning, has been in discussions with a number of SUSK and USO alumni, along with members of the broader Ukrainian community. These individuals and groups stepped up and committed to a strong and united SUSK. They committed to helping students find belonging at their university, and they committed to support and grow the next generation of leaders in our community.
I believe strongly that the Ukrainian Canadian Students Union is the center of excellence for leadership in our community. And this is, dear friends, the top 1% of the Ukrainian Canadian community. You are not the future leaders, you are the leaders of the Ukrainian Canadian community. And I saw that in space today during our advocacy workshop. When I saw the ability for you to formulate what are the action plans and see how you can take it to the next level, I am very confident in the future of our community. And I call upon all of you, as the leadership of our community, that you have an obligation to take on the leadership of our community, not just in Canada, but globally.
The students that attended this conference had an extremely humbling experience, being able to see the internment sites, being able to hear from speakers, being able to learn about internment of Ukrainians and non-Ukrainians through the arts. Without our volunteers, none of this would have happened, and I really want to thank the 2017-2018 National SUSK Executive for all of their hard work in ensuring that this event happens.
Також були оголошені результати виборів. Після вечері промов була весела забава, на якій грав гурт з Едмонтону «Забава у колі». Вранці, перед від'їздом, всі студенти зібралися, щоб обговорювати Конституцію Суску. Делегати Конгресу мали голосувати, щоб прийняти якусь зміну в цьому основному документі організації.
External relations, resolution 9. Whereas the 2018 National SUSK Congress recognizes the importance and value of having a national coordinating umbrella for Ukrainian-Canadian organizations in the spirit of the Ukrainian-Canadian Congress, UCC, and whereas SUSK is a registered national member organization of the UCC with a designated seat on the UCC Board of Directors, be resolved that the incoming SUSK National Executive and its member USOs continue to work together with the UCC and its provincial councils and local branches in the interest of the Ukrainian community. Basically, it means so that the executive and member clubs work with their local UCC branches where possible. It doesn't mean that you have to. It doesn't mean that every event, anything that your event has to go through UCC branch. It just means if you have a UCC branch, SUSK encourages its member clubs to work with their local branches. Okay, we put it to a vote. All in favor? All opposed? Abstentions? Carried.
Після того новообрана управа мала засідання. Переобрана голова СУСКу Стефанія Недошитко привітала членів управи і розповіла їм про їхні обов'язки.
Ми хочемо подякувати наші партнери Ukrainian Canadian Civil Liberties Foundation і Canadian First World War Internment Recognition Fund. Без них ця конференція не би відбулася.
На закінчення всі студенти, які брали участь в Конгресі, навчилися, як краще керувати своїми місцевими українськими студентськими організаціями. А крім того, вони мали чудову нагоду познайомитися з іншими однодумцями.